Hi, this is Dennis with Second Chance Tackle. Today I'm going to be working on a vintage Penn Long Beach reel. And I have several Long Beach reels in my library. And some folks always ask, well, why do you continue to do these or do different models of the same kind of a thing? Well, a lot of times folks only search for the particular model number. If they can't find it, they give up. And a lot of times folks don't understand the similarities and the differences between reels. So this gives us an opportunity to talk about the reel itself and, show you how to service it. This one I think is going to clean up very nicely. You're going to see there's an awful lot of tarnish and the like on there, but I think this one in the end is going to be very nice. This is the Penn Long Beach 67. So let's start talking about the differences in the reels and how to service them and the like. And, I'm going to start by taking off a few of the exterior pieces. As I do that, I want to encourage you to subscribe to my channel. And if you subscribe to my channel, please use that notification button. I work on all kinds of reels. This one is a vintage saltwater reel. There's others that are freshwater reels. I work on the current line. I just posted one on a Daiwa BG 3500 the other day, the current one. Spinning reels, bait casting reels. Saltwater reels, everything. So if you like to learn how to service your own fishing reel or generally about the reels themselves, then I would encourage you to subscribe to my channel. Well, we're going to start by noticing that the side plate on the 67, actually the 67, the 66, and the 68 all have a wider side plate than the other line, which is the 60 and 65 Long Beaches. It has a wider spool. These are very similar. The 66, 67, 68 are very similar to the Penn Senator reels in the size and capacity of the early 4.0s. The only difference is the setup on the drag washers and the extra trim ring on them. So this is a larger capacity reel. It's similar in nature to a Penn Senator, not the 65 and the 60 that it shares its name with in terms of Long Beach. I have a spinning post here, and I'm going to hold that post with a channel lock pliers, but not before I pad it with a piece of steel wool so that I don't scar it if that post starts to continue to turn. You always want to protect those posts, particularly on a vintage reel. Now, this one's got a lot of tarnish and wear, probably just from not being serviced in quite some time. But regardless, you want to do your best to maintain the patina, if you will, on it. Sometimes a spinning post you can hold with your hand, like I just did there. And why is that post spinning? It means that one of the sides, probably this side, the screw has loosened. Well, how does it loosen? Well, it loosens by boat vibration. And most of the time that you find that condition, they've been used on a trolling boat. And, the engine vibration on the floor causes that to shake the screws free over time. This is another example where we want to pad the post. I tried using my hand and didn't have the strength to hold it. And it doesn't take much. You can see the screw just kind of pops right up. But you got to get that initial stop to it. You'll see as you pull it out, sometimes you'll see that there's some corrosion on the screws and the like. We'll take care of that, just simply giving that a short bath of penetrating oil. When you remove the reel seat screws, those are these two, you're going to notice that they are shorter than the others. So when you go to reinstall, the two short ones go on the bottom. The other ones go into the crossposts. A quick little squirt of some penetrating oil and just kind of roll them around in that. Let that sit. And when I take the pieces and parts off, they go into a parts tray. I use the bottom of a fast food container for that purpose. You may have a different way to do it, and you're certainly welcome to use whatever method works for you. Well, we're going to remove the side plate and see that inside, that side plate hasn't been used very much. Our spool. And I think because of the age of this, we're going to go ahead and take the other end of those posts off so that we can do a good cleaning on that. Now, I won't take the time to show you all of the cleaning. I will describe my method in a moment, and we'll come back out with some clean pieces and parts to do the servicing on this reel. These are chrome plated, and generally they do a good job of keeping the corrosion off for the most part. Now, you have a job in that too. You need to make sure that your reels are hosed down after use, and that you get, particularly in a salt water environment, that you get that all those salts, the residual salts and the like, off of those before you put that reel away. Every day you should hose that off, and of course don't hose it off with salt water, but hose it off, take care of it in storage, and you should avoid kind of boat rash, which is a little bit of what this has. All right, I'm going to do the same thing here that I did with the other one. I'm going to use the steel wool to kind of cushion that. Now, there's other things you could use. You could use black electrical tape, for example. You can put that on the post and the like. But in this case, I found some success there with that steel wool, and I'll continue to do that. All right, two more pieces, and then I'll explain what I'm going to do. Do it, and we'll come back to the service of this reel, because I'm sure as much as you would like to watch me clean some pieces and parts here, it's going to take a lot of time, energy, effort, and a lot of what they call dead air space, I guess, right? You'll notice I'm putting the screws back where they came out. That makes it easier to install. Again, you have long screws for the cross posts and short screws for the reel seat. All right, what am I going to do now? I'm going to use this steel wool because of the severity of the debris and film and corrosion and whatever. I'm going to use a metal polish. In this case, I'm using an automotive one. It's Turtle Wax's chrome polish. Steel wool, polish, buff. We'll show it to you on this one. We're not going to show it to you on all. And I just hold it by the screw that I've got inserted in there, and a little bit of effort, and you will knock most of that off. Now, you're not going to take care of pitting, you're not going to take care of plating loss, but what you will do is you will take off that film, and you can notice the difference on the two of these. All right, well, I've got six posts. I've only done one. I've got a reel seat. We'll do the same thing on the spool. We'll do the same thing on the metal rings, and we will rejoin you when that that effort is done. Okay, so we've just spent quite some time now cleaning these up. I think you'll all agree that they're much better than they were. So a couple of things. You can get rid of the tarnish. Sometimes you're going to lift off some of the chrome plating that's been rusting away or corrosion, and you better take that off because you don't want that to cut into the line on your reel. But we're going to just reinstall this one side plate. And notice on this side plate, this click ratchet here has got a little bit of a groove worn in it from slamming the clicker on the spool. This one is almost impossible to replace. It's peened on. Some of the reels the pen makes have a C-clip, and it is replaceable. This one is peened, and I don't even know if you can get the replacement part at this point if you did want to peen it on yourself. But it's pretty tough to do that. I'm going to hand tighten the posts. That makes it easier to put the reel seat on. Just get them started. I'm not going to tighten them all the way. We'll come back and do that. But you can see how these have cleaned up. Everything cleaned up pretty nice. Again, you're not going to remove, or you're not going to be able to restore the lost metal finishes. But you can clean them up, get rid of the rough spots that are going to wear the line, and well, generally beautify the reel. Okay, last one of these. This makes it a whole lot easier to reinstall. Okay, so I've reattached the posts, I've reattached the reel seat. put a little bit of grease into the side bearing. We're going to put our spool back on. And now let's go tackle the actual service of this reel. So a little bit of just a narrative here. I took this off to clean it. And I've also used pen rod and reel cleaner on the side plates that will remove the film and grease and fishy parts and whatever else might be on that side plate. And I use, in that case, I do not use steel wool. I use a little kitchen scrubby pad. Scotch-Brite would be one of the manufacturers. That's not a Scotch-Brite pad, but you know what I mean. All right, we're going to take the four side plate screws out. And when you do this, I cup my hand on the back of it so I don't have the parts shooting out when I release this. And I also note that there's two different types of screws on this bridge. The top two have a partial thread to them, only the last maybe eighth of an inch or so. And the bottom screws are fully threaded. That's important when you go to reinstall the screws on this and all of the Long Beach reels, because the top two screws are holding springs. And if you put the fully threaded one in, there's a chance that one of the coils on the spring will catch the threads and impair performance. So fully threaded screws on the bottom, partially threaded screws on the top. Hand cupped, we're gonna push that through now. That last screw remains in there, but that will come out easy enough. And we're going to just pull this out now because there is a spring, which I was looking for right here. It's a little dog spring. And those of you that know the Penn Senators know that that's the Penn Senator main gear. So the smaller Long Beach reels only have a gear that extends to about here for the main gear. This one is a larger gear, and it's the one that's off the Penn Senator. So in this case, the main difference between this reel and the Penn Senator 4-hour reel is the extra trim ring on the side here, on the old black ones. Well, you saw that the fourth screw fell out. We're going to put that there. We've removed the dog, and that's what I was just searching for. We've removed the anti-reverse dog and put that into the parts tray. And I'll lay this off to the side for a moment, and I want to take a moment here, see if I can't push the pin on the sleeve of the bridge out. I'm going to use an awl, center it on that part, push it through like that, and that should enable you to remove the bridge sleeve and make sure that it's cleaned underneath. You can see in this case, this reel is fairly clean. I'm just going to use that paper towel. Make sure that the slot here is free of grease. That's the one where this pin will actually ride in and hold that sleeve in. It goes in like that. And the secondary one, which is where your oil port is on this bridge sleeve. So all cleaned, all good. And you'll notice that Penn does share a lot of parts. So this is a 67 reel, but it says the bridge says 66. That's because the bridge is the same on the 66, 67, and 68 models. The difference is the width of the spool. Here's your jack. And what does that say on that? It says 11-66, so the jacks are interchangeable. And we have our yoke and pinion gear and our two yoke springs. So I'm going to put those right into my parts tray so I don't lose those. And, well, we can see there's a lot of dried grease on the yoke. I'm going to do the same thing here. I'm just going to use the steel wool in this case to pull that dried grease off. That dried grease will impact the performance of the reel, and it's on both sides. So let's just clean that up. Make sure that's nice and clean. There's some varnished oils on this. We'll do the same thing. Varnishing is when that oil dries off. And on the back. And then with the pinion gear now, we want to inspect. Now, there's no grease in here. If there was grease in here, you would certainly want to grab a pick or something and pull it through. In this case, all of that grease, you saw where it went. It went onto the side posts and the other places in there. All right, that bridge is in good condition. We're going to just put a light coating of grease onto the bridge shaft. Bring that in. and push that pin back in. And when you push that pin in, make sure that it is not proud of that ridge line here, or otherwise you won't put your main gear back in. It's funny how that one little piece there is just enough that it will cause issues. In this case, we're fine. Okay, we've taken care of that. Quick cleanup on the side plate here. Again, most of that stuff is just plain leaked out. We'll just use a little bit of penetrating oil. We'll use a cotton swab. Now, you do not need to remove your eccentric, that's your eccentric or your eccentric spring, for a basic service. Of course, if that spring is broken, you want to replace the spring. If your eccentric is not turning easily, then of course you want to clear any old greases and the like there, but in this case, working fine. When you turn your eccentric, you're going to find that there is a gap right here. That's where that spring travels. Just put some oil into that gap. That'll help to keep that lubricated. All right, let's put the bottom of the assembly back in, or the top of the assembly, actually. We're going to put the two springs back into the cavities in the side plate. A little bit of grease onto that side plate bearing on the inside and the outside. A little bit of grease onto the eccentric. Next up, we want to grease the shoulders of the yoke with new grease. You saw the old grease. And we can put the gear back in. And now we'll take that gear yoke, place that over the bearing shaft, press down, take the jack, hook the jack over that yoke, around the stud. Make sure that the opening here has the stud in the center. Okay, last thing we want to do here is service this. I believe these are going to be hard washers, asbestos washers. Yep, they are. Okay. Now you can upgrade these if you like. There's a 7-stack system. But if these are working fine for you, no need to. Now in this case, these aren't working fine because you're seeing that this one is stuck to that. So you're going to need a lever like a utility knife here to go between the two and break that off just like that. So this is a braking material. It's hard. You don't need to do anything with that. But you do want to make sure that your washers are clear of any debris. Maybe sometimes it sticks and a little bit of that asbestos sticks to it. And again, this all-purpose piece of steel wool here is going to do that just fine. You want to make that smooth. And a drop of oil there probably wouldn't hurt to eliminate the sticking of that washer. So this is a 6-drag set. I'm not going to remove the one inside here because I know it's asbestos and it's okay and it's not stuck. We're going to leave that one in here. We're going to check the teeth on this one just like we did with the other. Again, if you find yourself with some dirt and debris in there, just grab the brush. I'm going to use a bristle brush for this. Pull through. Just like that. Check all the teeth, make sure they're uniform, that they're not bent, chipped, cracked, or otherwise. And then you can apply some grease. I use a artist brush to do that. And I'm using Penn Precision Real Grease. Sometimes people ask me what the blue grease is that I use. That's what it is. Not because this is a Penn Real, but because, well, it comes in big containers and I haven't had any issues with it, so I kind of use it. Let's take that main gear now and put that onto the post. Here's a shot of the grease that I use. And speaking of use, well, this reel gets used for deep sea trolling. That's basically what this one is. Bigger fish in a trolling environment. You can use some grease. I have some grease on my glove here, again, just to keep it from sticking. Grease isn't going to do anything in terms of the performance of the drag. All right, there's two washers that look like this. You saw me put one of those in. It's got a rectangular center and a round outside. There's one washer that has the circular center and two studs that come off of it. That's your middle washer. So we have one of these in. The second drag washer is in now. Find the holes or the slots in the main gear, and you can seat that middle washer just like that. The top one is a smaller red hard washer. Again, it doesn't get any lubrication. It's just a hard washer. It won't absorb the lubrication. So the whole idea with drag stack lubrication is to keep the real drag washers from drying out. It's not to facilitate the performance of the drag. So if you can't get the grease in, it's not going to help in any other way. There's a cap washer that goes on top of the last drag washer. Now we'll show you how to install the anti-reverse stall. Again, I mentioned that there's two different types of screws for the bridge. There's two that are threaded fully, and there's two that are partially threaded. You want to take one of the fully threaded screws and put it into the side here that's kind of topside when you're looking at it this way. Let's bring our gear bridge in. Push down on your pinion gear, bring the bridge in, and then rotate that bridge approximately on a 180. You have your threaded part of the screw coming through. This is your anti-reverse dog. It faces with that little point up. That little point up creates a cavity here. That's where that small spring that we paid attention to when we first took it off, your anti-reverse dog spring, gets lodged. I like to do this one manually. Set it on the one side, kind of wiggle my finger, and that sets the spring for the anti-reverse dog. When that's done, rotate it around, match the hole in the bridge to that screw, and then a couple of turns on the screw. Now don't tighten it down all the way, just get it started, because you need a little bit of play to align all of those bridge screws. I go opposite, so I was on the one side low, I go opposite high, and I come down with the fully threaded screw. That one up top was partially threaded. And then I bring this one back, the partially threaded other side, just like that, kind of an X pattern. Sometimes I call it XY's north, south, east, and west kind of thing. All right, and this is why I say you need a little bit of play, because that one's not quite lining up. So I'm gonna loosen this one a little bit. Funny how precision it is. There we go. Okay, and once you get that last one set, go back and tighten all of these, and we'll get ready to put the side plate back on. Just turn it at this point, make sure that you're hearing that anti-reverse. We've put a little bit of grease onto the spool. Just I like to put this into the disengage for the free spool. Makes it easier to seat the spool. Then align your post holes. And now we go back to our parts tray. Remember, most of these are long screws, but there are two short screws. So dig those out. Those will go in the real seat. Tighten up to one side. Line the other side. Again, just like we were doing on the bridge, makes it easier if you alternate your positions. That way you can steady the locations of the other holes. And then we'll go down and take one of the short screws into that bridge. Or real seat. Short ones go below. That's what, because if you use the long screws here, they're going to protrude from the other side. And if they do, there's a chance you can hook your line on it when you're letting line out. That'll cause a snap off, and well, you'll lose some valuable equipment. All right, once you do that, now it's just put them in wherever you like. You've steadied the side plate. You've made sure that there isn't a lot of torsion on it. And it's just a matter of tightening these down now. And remember, we still got to tighten the ones down on the other side. We only hand threaded those just to get that stabilized for that real seat. Okay, two more to go. I'm looking in my parts tray. I don't see any interior parts laying in there, so I guess we've put them all back together. I know we have. And again, if you have any questions on this reel or any reel, maybe you're working on one and having some difficulty, maybe you got a problem with a reel, you just can't understand what's causing it, leave those questions in the comment section. I do try to answer those, and well, that's the best way. Sometimes folks see the phone number on the business card that follows the video. They try and call me. Well, that's hit or miss, and I got to tell you that answering the questions in the comment section is a much more efficient way to get an answer. All right, we'll come back over this side, make sure that all of these are tightened down. Seems like I did a pretty good job with the hand threading. All right, now we have that free spool disengaged, or engaged, if you will. This should spin now. That's a little tight. So this is your spool adjuster on this side. You just want to back it off a little bit. And look at that spin. That's a beautiful little spinning reel right there, isn't it? That can spin forever. Wow. All right, here's your assembly of your star adjuster and handle to finish the work. I guess I buffed every metal piece with this little collar. So your spacer goes on next. We have another little spacer ring that goes underneath the star adjuster. I guess I didn't get that one either. Shame on me. This one's got some corrosion on it. That's the one that's exposed to all the salt water, so yeah, you're going to have that. Okay. That goes on. Now, on this one, you'll usually find a part number. This one says 10-66. That's the bottom side. If you can't find the part number, don't worry. One side of your star adjuster's got a gently rounded curve, and the other one's more flat. The gently rounded side goes out. Let's put the star adjuster on. Make sure that it threads nice and evenly. If it's not threading evenly, back it off. Do it again. Sometimes these are a little fickle. There we go. We've got that. Now, if you didn't take the bridge sleeve off, this is the place where you would put the oil. That's what it says on your handle nut or handle screw. It says oil. And from time to time, it makes a little bit of sense to go ahead and just put a drop in. All right, I'm going to take the handle now and just use that as a wrench to hold that bridge screw while I do that. Now we can put the handle screw back on. There's only one more piece in my parts tray, which is good, because there's only one more piece to install. All right, we're going to take our wrench. Now, this is an aftermarket wrench. If you have the original pen wrench, it's going to work just fine. I'll show you that one in a moment. This is just, this one's called an Allen Tanney wrench. And if you're servicing a lot of these pen reels, it has the advantage of being a little thicker and a little bit longer to provide leverage. And if not, if you have the original wrench, which is this one, it'll work just fine. All right, you align the hole in the scallop of the nut with the lockdown hole in the handle. Grab that little screw. And you're not going to have a lot of adjustability in these drag systems because they're thick and they don't wear. Tighten that down. We already showed you how nicely, whoops, when I put it in gear, how nicely that spins. Now we'll put it in gear, turn it. What a difference there is from the start to the finish of this reel. This is one of the beauty. It's going to go fishing for a long time to come. Again, you saw from the inside of this, the only difference between this and a Penn Senator 4-0 black-sided is the metal trim ring on the outside. Interesting, right? And well, I guess there's probably an extra screw maybe in the bridge. Not sure. All right, that's it. To our first responders and essential personnel, I want to say thank you for all you do, our public service and safety people, police, fire, rescue, EMTs, and the like. Thank you for your career choice and service. To everyone, enjoy the art of wheel repair. Get your wheels ready. Keep them fine-tuned, and they'll never fail you on the sea. This is Dennis with Second Chance Tackle. Have a great day.